Paul Waddell is Emeritus Professor of Theology and Religious Studies at St. Norbert College in De Pere. A native of Louisville, Kentucky, he received his BA in English from Bellarmine University in Louisville, his MDiv and his Master of Arts degrees from Catholic Theological Union in Chicago, and his PhD in Theology from the University of Notre Dame. He is the author of several books, including Friendship in the Moral Life, Becoming Friends, Worship, Justice, and the Practice of Christian Friendship, Happiness in the Christian Moral Life, An Introduction to Christian Ethics, and most recently, Living Vocationally, The Journey of the Called Life, that he co-authored with Charles Pinches. He has published articles on Christian theology, ethics, and spirituality in both scholarly and popular journals, and has given workshops and lectures both in the United States and abroad. Paul and his wife, Carmela, live in Green Bay, and both are members of St. Norbert College Parish. Let's welcome Dr. Paul Waddell.
Thank you, Tony, for that kind introduction. I very much appreciate the opportunity to be with you today on Good Friday to share some reflections on this important day in the church here and in our own Christian story. When I think of Good Friday, one of the most poignant rituals in the church year happens on that day. It's the part of in the liturgy where we venerate the cross. I always find it deeply moving, each of us making our way to the cross, no longer hiding our neediness, no longer covering up our brokenness or our wounds, but bringing them to the foot of the cross. I often think of Christians all over the world doing the same, human beings everywhere going to the cross with their sorrows and their pains, with their trials and their afflictions, with their unwiped tears and their unhealed hurts. It is a very hopeful moment for me because when we touch the cross, our sufferings become one with the sufferings of Christ. There is no more powerful symbol in Christianity than the cross. Why does the cross speak to us? Why does the cross have such power for us? Maybe it is because we too have known, shared in, and carried some cross. No matter how lucky we are, no matter how blessed our lives might be, all of us have known or will know some cross. Sooner or later, like Jesus, we meet the cross that bears our name. Those crosses can take many forms. It may be the cross of loneliness. It may be the cross of depression or lingering hopelessness. At some point, for all of us, it will be the cross of illness and physical suffering. For others, it is the cross of worry and anxiety and stress. For some, it is the cross of failed dreams and unchosen opportunities. This past year, during the pandemic, millions of people have been confronted by the cross of sudden unemployment and financial insecurity. For many people, it may be the cross of fear and confusion, the cross of emptiness and loss of meaning. For others, it is the cross of addiction or self-destructive behavior. Or it may be the cross of family problems or failed relationships. For single parents, it is likely the cross of continually feeling overwhelmed and exhausted. For far too many people in our world, it is the cross that comes to those who suffer from racism and prejudice, from economic injustice, from hatred and exclusion. And then there is the crushing cross we carry when people close to us die and we are weighed down with inconsolable grief and loss. No one wants to suffer, and no one should ever seek to suffer. But eventually, all of us, like Jesus, meet the cross that bears our name. There are many ways on Good Friday that we are called to think about the cross. There are many ways to understand it. But one of the most important messages of the cross that is revealed on Good Friday is that when we suffer, when anyone suffers, we never suffer alone. The crucified Christ tells us that God is with us, sharing in our suffering. God is with us, entering into our loss. God is with us, walking with us, comforting, consoling us, and supporting us when the cross comes our way. And that is because God is love. When you love someone, you don't want them to suffer, but neither do you want them to be alone when they do. It's no different with God. If God is pure, perfect love, it is never God's will that we suffer. It is never God's will that we grieve. But like anyone else who loves, God does not want us to suffer alone. Because God loves us, God never turns away from us when we suffer. Rather, God draws near. A very hopeful message of the cross, and one we need to take to heart and share with others, is that in the crucified Christ, God does not flee the sorrow and pain of our world, but enters into them, shares in them, and at every moment is part of them. The cross tells us that God is a fellow sufferer. God does not watch safely from a distance. God does not stand by impassively as we carry our cross. Christ on the cross reveals that the God we worship shares intimately in every experience of human life. Yes, God shares in our triumphs and our joys, but God also shares in our tears and in our pains, in our disappointments, and in all our hurts and losses. The cross tells us that our cross is God's cross too. When we suffer, God suffers. When we grieve, God grieves. How do we know this? How can we be sure? All we have to do is look closely at the life and ministry of Jesus as Jesus made his way to the cross. If we skim the Gospels, where do we find Jesus? So often we find him at the center of some great suffering. It happens all the time. Jesus cannot go far without being drawn into somebody's pain or being asked to minister to someone's affliction. Think of the story from the 5th chapter of the Gospel of Mark, where Jesus encounters Jairus, an official of the synagogue whose daughter is dying. On his way to Jairus' house to heal his daughter, Jesus encounters the woman who for 12 years has suffered with an illness that has only grown worse. In these gospel stories, Jesus heals. Jairus' daughter is restored to life, and the afflicted woman is freed from her suffering. But what each story reveals is that Jesus is not some dazzling wonder worker who heals but remains untouched by those who suffer. Jesus is not a Messiah who floats safely above the sorrows and tears of life, but a Messiah who makes himself vulnerable to the wounded, a Messiah who makes himself vulnerable to all the bruises and brokenness of life. Jesus is not a bronze Messiah who heals but feels nothing, but a Messiah who heals only by first entering into relationship with those who suffer, a Messiah who heals only by drawing near. That is compassion. Perhaps more than anything, this is the message of the Good Friday cross. Compassion means to suffer with or to suffer together. With compassion, instead of turning away from those who suffer, struggle, and are in pain, we turn toward them and draw near to them. Compassion is a very difficult virtue to practice because compassion demands that we make our hearts available to another's pain, that like Jesus, we make ourselves vulnerable to the sorrows and sufferings of others. Compassion is the form love takes in the face of suffering, because with compassion, instead of fleeing those who suffer, we befriend them. The message of the cross is that in the crucified Christ, God befriends us in our suffering. There's a Jesuit theologian at Boston College named James Keenan. And James Keenan says that by becoming human in Jesus, God entered into the chaos and messiness of life. By becoming human in Jesus, God was immersed in the sorrow and the pain, the darkness and the uncertainty, in order to be with us and to help us in our need. In Jesus, God is fully immersed into the human condition. There is nothing in human life, none of its pain, none of its loneliness, none of its tears, none of its sorrow, that are unknown to God and that have not been felt by God in Christ. That is why the cross is such a powerful symbol of hope. When we go through difficult times, we often feel isolated and alone, or we find ourselves thinking, if only someone would understand what I am going through. The cross assures us that somebody does. God does. God understands because in becoming one of us in Jesus, God was immersed fully into every dimension of life, including its sorrow and its pains. The message of the cross to every sufferer is God knows, God understands. Many years ago, I read a book by Nicholas Wolterstorff, then a professor of theology at Yale Divinity School. The book was entitled Lament for a Son. The book began as a diary that Wolterstorff kept during the days and months following the tragic death of his 25-year-old son, Eric, while mountain climbing in Austria. It is a powerful, unforgettable book because Wolterstorff is painfully honest. He talks about the overwhelming grief he felt over his son's death and the truly inconsolable loss he suffered in the death of a son who, at 25, was at the prime of his life. He speaks of how he would be walking down the street, see his son's old friends, and look for Eric in the group. Every year when his son's birthday came around, he would calculate how old Eric would have been if he were still alive. The pain and the suffering that he felt, that he experienced when his son died, continued and would sometimes overtake him. He even would find himself imagining Eric coming home someday, greeting his family as if his death had been some horrible nightmare from which they would all soon awaken. But in Lament for a Son, Wolterstorff also talks a lot about God and does not hesitate to admit that the death of his son Eric shook his confidence in God and made him angry with God. He wondered why a God who is said to be all-powerful, why a God who is said to be all-good and all-loving, did not intervene. Why didn't God do something? He tells the friends who tried to console him by assuring him that God must have had reasons for taking Eric. But no reasons of God would ever be good enough to make sense of his son's death. No reasons of God would ever make his son's death acceptable. For Wolterstorff, the question that haunted him was, where was God when my son suffered and died? What he finally came to see as he grieved Eric's death is that we will never find an answer to suffering. We will never be given a satisfying explanation. The cross shows us that Christianity does not provide an answer to the universal human experience of suffering. But what Christianity in Christ's cross does provide is a revelation. The revelation of the cross is that God does not give answers to our suffering, but does something much riskier. God shares in our sufferings. God enters into our wounds. As Walter Stauff wrote, instead of explaining our suffering, God shares it. He goes on to say, God is not only the God of the sufferers, but the God who suffers. The pain and fallenness of humanity have entered into his heart. Through the prism of my tears, I have seen a suffering God. What does this message of the cross mean for us? If the cross tells us that in Jesus, God entered into the chaos and messiness, the suffering and sorrow of others, to be with them in their need, then as followers of Christ, aren't we called to do the same? As Christians, we have many callings in our lives, but the cross tells us that one of those callings is to do for others what God in the crucified Christ did for us, to befriend them in their suffering, to stand with them in their sorrow and their pain. The Greek word for church is ekklesia, which literally means to be called out. The church is the people who have been called out of their individual existences into a community by God. Resurrection Parish in Alloway, Wisconsin, is an ekklesia, because each of you has been called out of your homes, out of your private personal lives, into a community by God. But God calls all of us together in order to send us forth. God gathers us and then gives us work to do. Our work, our mission, is to carry on the mission and ministry of Jesus. One very important way to do so is by being ministers of God's compassionate love to others. That is our calling. That is the message of Good Friday, to be ministers of God's compassionate love to others. There are so many opportunities to do so because the crucified Christ lives all around us. The crucified Christ wears many faces and can be found in many places. We meet the crucified Christ in one another. We meet him in the often hidden, silent struggles of family members, neighbors, friends, and strangers. We meet the crucified Christ in the lonely who long for any human connection. We meet the crucified Christ in those who feel forgotten, abandoned, or overlooked. We meet the crucified Christ in the poor, the hungry, and the homeless. We meet the crucified Christ in migrants and refugees seeking safety and a new life. We meet the crucified Christ in those suffering from racism and prejudice, in all the men and women who are treated as something other than a living, breathing child of God. We meet the crucified Christ in the sick. We meet the crucified Christ in those mourning the death of someone they love. We meet the crucified Christ all around us every day, in all the people who are struggling with the weight of a cross. Can we use the power of compassion, a compassion infused with justice and love, to remove the nails of their crosses and to help heal their wounds? Can we do something to take them down from their cross and help them know life again? Good Friday summons us to take the message of the cross to heart, the message that God is with us in our suffering, and to share that with others by standing with them in their suffering, doing what we can to alleviate their sorrow, to make things better for them, but even when we cannot, standing with them. We give hope to those who suffer when we minister to them the compassion that God has shown us in the crucified Christ. Many years ago, when I was living in Chicago, I met a woman who had suffered much in her life. Her family was poor, and so she often had to find a way to make it on her own. Her marriage ended in divorce. She experienced disappointments and hardships with her children. Many times, she was barely scraping by. She certainly had known many crosses, but she was not bitter or resentful. I asked her why, and I will never forget her answer. She said, "The cross stands for love. When I look at the cross, I don't see suffering, I see love." The cross stands for love. That's the message of Good Friday, a message we are called to take to heart and share as a blessing with others.